Hello, hello. This is Johannes Vuotri from Holteran. Today we will talk about top tools to support your mobile development progress. So, if you haven't yet released any application either on the iOS App Store or Google Play Store, you might not be familiar, but you actually need to establish your developer digital existence in the internet, other than just releasing the application. So the that's gonna mean by hosting your developer web page, each application must have privacy policies publicly available, and you need to host them somewhere. So my choice for hosting is Firebase. So let's take a look at that one today as the first subject, and how easy it is actually to deploy your static web pages into the Firebase hosting, and why, what else the Firebase is great tool for regarding the mobile applications, and lastly regarding the Firebase, what to avoid in the Firebase, because there's some serious issues in some of the features if you intend to for instance use it for the back end development side. It's not a good choice. I'll tell you in a minute why. And then the second topic will be about the back end development. Where to host your back end, where to establish your back end server instead of, let's say, in Firebase, even though you could. And my choice will be HetchNet Cloud. I'll show you in a minute why. And of course, establishing your own backend from scratch is quite a job, but hey, it's worth the while when it's done. And third is the tool to be used as a development framework in the backend server side. So there are many options, but as a Android developer, as a Kotlin developer to be specific, Ktor is the choice for your backend framework because it is native Kotlin coding and Kotlin is awesome. So we'll be focusing on these three topics today, and let's start. Let's start from the Firebase with the best features, and you can get into Firebase in console.firebase.google.com, and if you're not familiar already in here, but hey, this is the landing page, so just create a project. You can see that I have in here my all of my Android projects, as well as I do have my ho developer homepage. So let's take a look at the hosting in here. So the hosting is one of the Firebase's top features for developers, especially for the mobile developers, because at least when you are an Android developer, you get to host static web pages for free. So this is really easy. I'll show you an example of hosting. So I'll link you up into this page where you have quick start. It's like 4-step. Install the CLI tools, initialize your project in the CMD, and deploy to your site. That's it. So, of course, it's gonna involve a little bit of HTML, JavaScript coding, but let's see what we did in here, what it means to host in Firebase. So, you have a simple page where you want to showcase your apps, you want to have your landing page, and of course, in the beginning, I told that every developer, every app has to have privacy policies. So these are the must-dos in the digital presence of your homepage. So recently, I just updated my resources, images, privacy policies, and the updated the app pages. So let's see the result we had in here. We had new icons, we had new HTML pages, for instance, for the PB save. So that didn't come from online, But I'm now just gonna go into my local repository. This is my computer. We have a project called Firebase. Inside we have our developer homepage project, and the public folder will hold anything that's gonna be released while deploying. And let's cd into our homepage project. Okay, here we are. All we gotta do is say Firebase login. Okay, we are logged in, and then we can say Firebase deploy. And there it goes. It's gonna do pretty much everything for you, because Firebase already took care of the back-end hosting infrastructure. Now we just need to upload our resources into the Firebase hosting. So let's see what happened. We are in our homepage. Okay. We get into our app listing, and here we have the new resources for every app that we wanted to showcase. That's it. Some YouTube pages. And of course, that's what I'm talking about the must-do liabilities you have to showcase among the app your privacy policies. So all this you can do with the Firebase hosting service instantly and free. So forget about WordPress, forget about all the paid hosting services. You can do it for free, at least as an Android developer, in the Firebase. So that's the top number one feature to get going on the release of apps and app development. So there's another really positive feature on the Firebase, because now we get to manage the root content within the project itself. So we have a total control of the code in a raw format, as it's supposed to be coded. So it's you're in control of every aspect, whether you need to write JavaScript simple functionalities or manage the overview of the HTMLs and styles. So forget about the WordPress and all the framework based graphic UI based web development services. Go back to basics. Back to coding, okay? Beyond that, you will have the total control of your root items, as I do in here. Anything we add in here, we get to upload into our hosting service, which then again can be used to support the app integration into Google services. For instance, if you ever need to establish AdMob for your ad monetization, you must have your app ads.txt configuration file publicly available in your service somewhere. Either it's going to be in your backend, or either it's going to be in your web hosting, because you need to link your developer page into Google AdMobs, into Google Play Console as a developer while you're releasing apps. Now, you can now directly place it into your Firebase public resources. And while we just deployed our project, it's going to be available in there, and Google's going to crawl that and use that for your app monetization. So that was the second most important thing that we can do. We can actually now release configuration files while we are hosting our free web page in the Firebase. Now, the third one that I really do like, I already flinched it just a bit. It's all about Firebase remote configuration. So let's take a look at from here. Each of the app will also have so-called remote configuration setting in your Firebase project, whether it's the application or whether we do have now our homepage project in here. Now, I don't have anything set up currently in for my developer web page. It's really simple page just to do the show the liability, showcase apps, etc. So, but in here, if this was app, I could now create my configuration and just start listing easy key and a value pairs for variable configurations, and we could inject those values online into all of our devices if we truly would like to. This is kind of like the most common and most makes sense solution example to host your remote configuration based credentials in the Firebase and inject them into as an online, if you ever need to change them, into all application clients and use that to log in into your application backend services, which you have obviously established somewhere else, but you can inject any kind of a value, change the most basic principle nature of the application in some means via Firebase remote configuration. For instance, you can save changing links, URI links into the remote config, and if you ever would need to change them, just change the values, release new values, and every client's gonna get the new values when the app next time gets restarted. Last, what not to do in Firebase. Do not establish backend solutions, which, by the way, you can also do in the Firebase by going to build Firestore database or real-time database. But truly, if your application or if your any kind of a solution requires actual backend integration, which will eventually be quite data exchange intensive, it's gonna backlash big time because these are really expensive. It doesn't matter if you use Firestore database or real-time database, it's gonna be the same even if you would establish that into Amazon AWS or Azure. As an indie developer, you're gonna regret because it's gonna make you pay real money. And I'm not talking about hundreds of dollars. It's gonna get finally into thousands of dollars. And because the more data intensive your backend integration gets, it's gonna scale into an expensive solution. So, and just as a warning, when you make some background studies, how developers actually have failed to integrate these. One of my worst nightmares when I did small demo apps and I actually integrated functionalities into real-time database was that if I would ever release this application and I would actually make a serious bug in the program, which would cause infinite looping or some kind of a non-stopping data query loop into the database, and that would scale up into thousands of users, I would be broke because probably Firebase would send you a bill of tens of thousands or hundreds of thousands worth of money to be paid just because of a silly programming error. That's why take your time, establish a real backend database and backend service solution into a service supplier, which lets you host your own Linux or Windows server with a fixed amount of money per month. Now that we're past the phase that we're not about to actually establish backend into Firebase, I will give you one example which is cost efficient, and you'll get to host your own Linux server, for instance. Now, just a heads up and a notice, I don't get a single dime of money by displaying this host provider, Hetzner Cloud, neither I do not get any money from Firebase, Google Firebase service supplier. But I just want to show this one because this is a really good one, and I'm actually using Hetzner Cloud to host my application server-side solution. So you can get familiar by coming in here, and it's really simple. It seems that these days you get to host in Germany, Finland, and USA. And look at the fixed amount of prices in here. It fully depends on what kind of a CPU and setup you need, but at the lowest cost, about 4 to 5 euros a month, and you'll get a sufficient Linux server, for instance. If you want to scale up, you can scale up anytime, but this will involve the necessity for you to invest in the know-how of establishing your own Linux server and coding it and making all the parameter setups, firewalls, etc., etc., via your command prompt tool. And then you'll get to code your own server-side framework, for instance, with Ktor, as I do. I don't know if you would like to use any other framework environment, programming and environment for your backside server-side solution, but I'm all about into Kotlin and therefore into Ktor. But definitely, while you are making your studies about how could you establish your server-side solution and the back-end, check out Hetzner, because in today's world, normally, typically, you only will get the names of Google or Amazon or Microsoft or whatever big name. But don't forget about these ones. This is perfect, for instance, Hetzner for India developers. Nothing else to say. I like it. It's good. It's cost efficient. And it has served me really well. So let's jump into Ktor. So if you're still wondering, especially if you're an Android developer and you are wondering what framework, what programming language should you use to code your backend solution. Now, stop here. If you develop Android, especially you do use Kotlin, there shouldn't be any other question than to use the Ktor. That's the best option for me because I get to code native Kotlin. And these days, the document for the Ktor, definitely for the 2.3 version and up from there, also from all the way, let's say from 2.2 and up, the documentation is really good. And there is already in the internet different examples from people who develop Ktor-based backend themselves. So you can go and check YouTube videos, you can go and check the official documents in here, and they even have pretty nice setup service on their webpage. So you can pretty much get a pre-configuration for your backend and finish it in your code editor and then deploy that project. Of course, one last hint, you should definitely wrap your Ktor solution into Docker. So, not to get any further, Docker is my choice of wrapping my backend solution and then deploy that into the backend server side. Now, with Docker, I can deploy my backend solution into any server side. I can get it out and just redeploy it. So it's not like fully, it's embedded in a container, which lives its own life pretty much. And if I want to run my official Ktor production server in the same Linux server from Hetzner Cloud, I can do that. And at the same time, I can now deploy my test server on the parallel and run both of those instances in their own containers. And on top of that, I get to deploy MongoDB as the third container, and they all get to communicate with each other from container to container. That's all possibility to set up your backend solutions inside Docker. So it is perfect. So I will link you a couple of videos from my YouTube that I've done for Ktor and for Docker And I'm actually deploying those solutions into Hetzner Cloud. So, but I don't have any deep inside videos for the Hetzner itself. So it's all about you getting familiar, making the studies and making your choice for the service provider. And pretty much after that, you can deploy your Ktor and Docker solutions. So that's how you get to deploy a real custom backend solution with these tools into a service provider that lets you host your self, let's say, self-contained backend solution, for instance, a Linux service. But still going back to Firebase, I warned you to not use Firestore database and real-time database. I forgot to tell you that there's one bad feature also in here. You don't get to just deploy your Docker custom functions wrapped in a Docker and Ktor server, because these have their own fixed functions. So you'll be stuck on the functionalities what these guys let you do with the back end. So again, making highly customer solutions, your own solution functions, etc., etc., there's another reason to not stick with the Firebase addition than maybe making demo applications on the back end side. So those are my top tools to be used for mobile and web development. I hope you like today's topic. This wasn't any coding video, but This is kind of an inside view what it actually means to be a mobile developer. It doesn't matter if you're indie developer or if it's your daily work to be a mobile developer. If you're persistent to become or be a mobile developer without in time, while time goes, you're bound to stumble on these issues. How to host your web page, how to establish your digital presence as a developer, how to integrate your applications in the back-end server-side solutions, where do you host your back-end server-side solution, what framework will you be using, and there's going to be hundreds of issues and questions related into that, and you cannot tackle all of these issues at one time. So when I started going through these topics and becoming more familiar with these topics, I realized I need to take one goal, one step at a time. And maybe for you, it's going to be that, hey, this week, maybe you make a target for yourself that this week is going to be the week, or this month is going to be the month, or this year is going to be the year that I actually establish my web page hosting in Firebase or in whatever service provider. Once that is done, sooner or later it will be done, you'll take a next target. Again, maybe this year is going to be the year that you develop your own server-side solution. It's not going to be great in the beginning. It's going to be, but at least you get it started. You get the configurations correct. You get to make the deals. You get to own your domains and get them interconnected into your application. That's going to be a really cool step. Actually, as a developer, I'm not so into web development and front-end development. I just do it because I need to have a digital presence, a front plate to host my applications basics and the privacy policies and so on. But back end, on the other hand, that is really interesting topic for mobile developer, because you get to interconnect some functionalities that are not obvious for the user but are critical to scale your application into new dimensions. Because application itself can only be self-contained so far, and at the end of the day, to scale it up, you need back-end solutions to support your application or feed additional data or store additional data into your database. So about databases, I didn't give you any view on that one, but my choice of database is of course MongoDB. So perfect MongoDB solution for the backend side. So this is a good place to stop this video before I make any more gibberish. And I think that's the full stack for mobile developer that will do all the jobs. Be a mobile developer, get familiar with Firebase solutions, find your backend service host provider where you can actually host your own Linux server. Use Kdor or some other framework to code your backend solutions. Wrap it in a Docker, that's gonna be perfect. Use MongoDB for your backend. For me, the stack doesn't get any better. Okay, we'll be back.